So here's the second half of the drugs of abuse part. Again, same picture of the brain. And this time I've highlighted for you the other classes of drugs, which include the sedative hypnotics, the hallucinogens, the dissociative drugs, the so-called club drugs, steroids, and inhalants. And that will round out the morning. So let's start out with the sedative hypnotic drugs. The sedative hypnotic drugs include the benzos and the barbiturates and other drugs, which are such as, you'll notice, zolpidem, which is Ambien on the list, and Zappelon, which is another, I think that one might be Sonata. That's the other sleeping medication that people sometimes have. And of course, alcohol, which we have already discussed, is also, we haven't talked about alcohol. Alcohol is also the biggest sedative hypnotic drug, excuse me. So those are all in that same class. So sedative hypnotic drugs do have clinical utility. They are useful in modern medicine. They help put people to sleep. They treat anxiety. They are used as anti-seizure medications. Interestingly, 12 to 20% of American adults are using a sedative hypnotic drug in any given year. 90% of any patient on a med-surg unit are prescribed these drugs, and 2 billion with a B tablets of Valium are prescribed every year in the United States. So lots of this around. All sedative hypnotics have significant activity on what's known as GABA, which is one of the neurotransmitters. And so the prototype sedative hypnotic is a barbiturate like phenobarbital. The most commonly used one is a benzodiazepine, of course, other than alcohol. The major avenue of supply for these drugs is, of course, the doctors, because they're prescribing them. You can use these drugs by mouth as a shot in your arm or through an IV. There is tolerance and cross-tolerance with these medications. Sedative hypnotics are the class of drugs that have a life-threatening withdrawal. So if somebody is withdrawing from Valium or withdrawing from Xanax or withdrawing from alcohol, that's potentially a medical emergency and those people need attention. One of the things that you may recall happened in the Cuyahoga County Jail is that I think it was the singer Levert, his brother, was in the Cuyahoga County Jail and died of a benzodiazepine withdrawal. So they didn't give him his benzos, which were prescribed to him, and he ended up going into withdrawal and passing away. So yes, this is potentially a life-threatening situation. There is on the market a benzodiazepine blocker, and it is called flumazenil, but it isn't used very much because it does have some side effects of its own, including seizures. So it's not like something that you can just sort of throw around there and help people with. It actually can cause its own issues. So what is the signs and symptoms of sedative intoxication and withdrawal? Well, if, you know, most people in the world have had the experience of being drunk, so you see what's on that slide. Happy feelings, sometimes sad feelings, you get tired, the slurred speech, the incoordination. The nystagmus refers to abnormal eye movements, where your eyes move back, your eyeballs move back and forth abnormally. And then, of course, the cognitive impairment. And then all the things that you see listed on the right are all of the opposite of those things. And those are what happens to people that are in alcohol or sedative hypnotic withdrawal. So there are two basic types of sedative withdrawal. You can either wean the person off of the drug itself. Okay, that's one way to do it, not as comfortable. Or you can substitute a similar drug, usually like clonopin or phenobarbital or Librium, and then wean that drug. Or you can actually substitute an anticonvulsant like Depakote, but the data for that isn't as strong. So there are those methods of treating the sedative withdrawal. And when you treat sedative withdrawal, you basically have to figure out how much of the drug were they taking, and then how much of that is equal to 30 milligrams of phenobarbital. So this is a phenobarbital equivalency chart. So it shows you that, for example, lorazepam at the top of the second column, that's Ativan. 2 milligrams of Ativan is equal to 30 milligrams of phenobarb, and then you will see Second from the bottom on the left-hand side, diazepam, which is also known as Valium, 10 milligrams of that drug is equal to 30 milligrams of phenobarb. So we use kind of phenobarb as the measuring stick. And so, for example, if I knew that someone was abusing 50 milligrams of Valium a day, as well as 10 milligrams of Ativan a day, that's a whole heck of a lot of medication, then I would know based on this chart that they needed, let's see if I could do the math here, somewhere in the neighborhood of like 300 or 400 milligrams of phenobarbital to balance that out. So you use this chart to try to figure out, based on what the person's been abusing, how much phenobarbital is it going to take to detox them. So that's the usefulness of the chart. All right, so we're switching gears to another class. This is called the hallucinogen class. What you see on the top is the mushrooms that contain psilocybin, which is a hallucinogen. And then what you see on the bottom is the peyote cactus, which contains the drug called mescaline. And both of those things can make you hear things and see things that aren't there. So those are examples of hallucinogens that are found in nature. And if you go and if you live in places like Arizona where they have these cactuses, there was a point at which people were like stealing those out of people's front yards because they knew what they were and they were trying to get high from them. So I don't think they would grow, you know, up in our yards. But people do recognize them and say, oh, okay, I can use that for some purposes other than a pretty garden. So then this is an example of a hallucinogen that was manufactured in a lab. So Albert Hofmann, in 1943, as part of the Sandoz Pharmaceutical Company, basically discovered LSD. And so this slide tells you a little bit about what he experienced. And it's very interesting. He says, everything in the room spun around. The familiar objects and pieces of furniture assumed grotesque, threatening forms, which were in continuous motion. And then he says, even worse than these demonic transformations of the outer world were the alterations that I perceived in my inner being. It seemed like a demon had invaded me, had taken possession of my body, mind, and soul. So, sounds kind of like a bad trip to me. The trips aren't always bad, but they can be bad. So that is an example of what is it like to be on LSD. So what kind of hallucinogens are young people being exposed to? This is a slide that shows you 8th graders, 10th graders, and 12th graders, and it shows you LSD, PCP, and other hallucinogens. And so you can see that LSD is probably the one that our kids have the most exposure to. And the left-hand side number shows you the percentage. So somewhere like 2 to 4% of 8th graders have tried LSD, 6 to 8% of 10th graders have tried LSD, and 8 to 13% of 12th graders have tried it. So the other hallucinogens, not as much, PCP down in like the 2 to 3% range. So let's get into talking about specifically what some of these things are. LSD stands for lysergic acid diethyl amide. Psilocybin, which I had told you was in the mushrooms, is also known as 4-hydroxydimethyltryptamine. Mescaline, which is found in the cactus, is also called 3,4-5-trimethoxyphenylethylamine. Then there is a drug known as STP, and it's also called 2,5-dimethoxy-4-methylamphetamine, and also known as DOM. So there's many, many, many different kinds of hallucinogens. Like I said, this is the tip of the iceberg. There are other things that are hallucinogenic, which you may or may not be familiar with. Nutmeg, the same thing that you put in eggnog and cookies and stuff. Nutmeg, if you take enough of it, and you'd have to take a whole lot of nutmeg, has a substance called myristicin, which is hallucinogenic. Morning glory seeds, those big, beautiful plants with those big flowers, morning glory seeds have something called LSA, which, as you can see by the name, is related to LSD. And then my favorite, my personal favorite, is something called bufotenine. And in the southwestern part of the United States, there are toads, and there are people who lick the toads to get the bufotenine off of the glands that are on the toad's back, okay? So certain people in this country lick toads to have a hallucinogen from bufotenine. So yes, it is a true story. I couldn't make this stuff up, right? Couldn't make this stuff up. All right. So this next slide shows you, interestingly, how psilocybin in the mushrooms and mescaline from the cactus and LSD have that ring-like structure that looks hauntingly familiar to serotonin, which is the same serotonin that is implicated in depression. It's the same serotonin that we take Prozac and Lexapro and Celexa for. So isn't it interesting that some people who take Prozac and Lexapro and Celexa, one of the very rare side effects of that is that you can actually hallucinate from those drugs. And I have actually heard stories of people who swore up and down that they hallucinated when they took Prozac. And I look at this slide and I can kind of see why, because it's got sort of the same chemical structure as some of the hallucinogens that are out there. Now, obviously, that doesn't happen in everybody. You know, 95% of people who take Prozac are never going to hallucinate. But there's going to be that few percentage of people that might do it. So just something to be aware of. That's a reminder that all of the hallucinogens basically work on the serotonin system of the brain. So hallucinogens cause hallucinations as well as sympathetic arousal. And sympathetic arousal is merely increased heart rate, increased blood pressure, increased body temperature. The primary mechanism, as I've already said, is the serotonin system. And it's most prominent in your cortex and in a part of your brain called locus coeruleus. LSD is the most commonly used hallucinogen, and it has three nicknames, or the ways that it's sold. They call it micro dots, or window panes, or blotter. You will start to hallucinate 30 to 90 minutes after you take it, and the hallucinations can last for up to 12 hours. You can get rapid tolerance, but there is no withdrawal syndrome reported. Now, hallucinogens can also cause flashbacks. And in the DSM-4, there's a special name for the flashbacks that are caused by hallucinogens, and that is called hallucinogen persisting perception disorder. So this is when you haven't taken LSD for 10 years, but suddenly you'll have an LSD-like experience. So that's a flashback. So people can see light trails, flashing lights, other visual disturbances, and other sensory experiences. And then some people can get psychotic from taking too many hallucinogens, and the psychosis can be long-lasting. Most of the time, the psychosis goes away just as soon as you know that the drug gets out of your system, but sometimes you can get a persistent psychotic disorder, which, again, can be bad, difficult to treat. So hallucinogen intoxication and withdrawal, the intoxication is listed there on the left-hand side. The withdrawal has not been described, so there really is no such thing as a hallucinogen withdrawal. People just don't withdraw from them. So the next class of drugs is called the dissociative drugs, and there are three members of this family. And one of them might interest you when you figure out what it is. The first instance is the phencyclidine, or PCP. The second one is ketamine. And the third one is good old dextromethorphan. Yes, Robitussin. In the same family as PCP. So maybe something that you weren't aware of. Okay. Dissociative drugs, they distort your visual and auditory perceptions without giving you true hallucinations. And what they do is they produce feelings of being detached from your environment. And they exert their effects not only on dopamine, but also on glutamate. So let's talk about PCP first. So PCP, as you may be aware or familiar, people can have very unpredictable behavior. They can have decreased pain perception. They can have all kinds of abnormal eye movements, also known as nystagmus. They can have difficulty speaking and difficulty walking. And of course, they can also have the hyperarousal of their body in terms of increased heart rate, high blood pressure, and fevers. And if you take enough PCP, you can get delirious and have a psychotic episode. PCP, believe it or not, was initially developed as a general anesthetic, but it was never approved for use in human beings because people were very delirious and agitated as they came out of anesthesia. PCP is commonly used to lace other drugs. Most commonly, it laces marijuana. So at least what I have heard from my clients is the marijuana plus the PCP is known as wet. Sometimes marijuana plus the formaldehyde is known as wet. So when people say they're smoking wet, you kind of have to ask them, which one are you talking about? The PCP itself can be taken by mouth. It can be smoked. It can be injected. The effects will occur within minutes, and they are unpredictable. The effects last for several hours to several days. So someone can get really psychotic and have to be in the psychiatric hospital, and there is no tolerance or withdrawal described. Okay, so ketamine. Ketamine has some nicknames. It's called Special K, K, Vitamin K, or Cat Valium, Kitty Valium. This is actually an anesthetic that they use in veterinary medicine. But they also do use ketamine sometimes to like put young children out that are having like MRIs and stuff, or at least they used to. I don't think they do that anymore, but it used to be used in child anesthesia as well. So the effects are similar to PCP, and it can cause neurotoxicity. It's definitely less potent than PCP. It has gotten somewhat of a reputation as a date rape drug as well. So that's ketamine. And then dextromethorphan, which I said was in your cough medicine, and it is available over the counter. Cough preparations, again, you have to drink bottles of this stuff. So most of us will have one or two teaspoons, okay, and then we won't cough anymore. But if you drink 2 to 4 ounces, which is one half to a whole bottle all at once, you can get mild stimulation and visual disturbances. If you drink 1 to 2 bottles, that's when you can start to dissociate. And so the other thing to be aware of is when you have these bottles of cough syrup, a lot of them can also have antihistamines like Benadryl in there, and they can have decongestants in there as well. And that can also cause problems when you're taking them in those mega amounts. And just in case you are thinking, gosh, I don't think that addiction to that could ever happen, there was actually a patient that was treated at University Hospitals about 2 months ago who was buying, you know, 3 to 4 bottles a day. It was a young person, I think it was a teenager, and just drinking 3 to 4 bottles of this a day. So yes, the addiction to this substance is actually possible. So that's dextromethorphan. A lot of times the nickname, they'll call it roboing, like Robitussin, or they'll call it robo-tripping. So if you hear that terminology, that's what they're talking about. This is a picture of some common inhalants. So we are switching gears to talk about inhalants. So inhalants is a huge class of drugs and includes things that we use for other purposes, like gasoline, like paint thinner, like airplane glue, like whiteout, like other kinds of nitrites and aerosols, things that come in cans, you know, spray paint cans, those kind of things. So inhalants are very cheap, very readily available, absolutely not regulated at all, and it's easy to conceal that you're using inhalants. Now, of course, who uses inhalants? Young people. So it's most common in teens and preteens, and then they move on to other things from the inhalants. So this is kind of a almost flip-flop of the slide that I showed you before with the LSD and the PCP in the 8th graders, 10th graders, and 12th graders. And what you can see is that it's the 8th graders who are using between 4 to 6% of inhalant. You know, they're the ones who use at a rate of 4 to 6%. And as you get to 10th grade and 12th grade, that use drops down to 2 to 4%. Why? Because they have found marijuana and alcohol. by the time they get to 10th and 12th grade. So it's the younger people, the eighth graders, who are into the inhalants more so than the older kids. And so as the mother now of an eighth grader, yeah, this is a scary slide. It's like, okay, that's pretty scary stuff. You know, one out of 20 eighth graders is using inhalants. So inhalant intoxication can cause, of course, the happy feeling of euphoria. It can also make you look like you're drunk with the can't walk straight, slurred speech, decreased reflexes. It can cause hallucinations. There has not been any inhalant withdrawal described. There are various ways to take the inhalants, and they include huffing or bagging, as it's known, or you can sniff or snort things. You can have balloons filled with nitrous oxide and inhale that way. And what happens is that you get very intoxicated very fast. And what can happen is that, I mean, it can be fatal. So someone who is out there abusing inhalants can actually die from doing it, and it usually ends up being somebody who is a preteen. So it's usually a very sad story when you hear those stories. Some of the signs that somebody's using an inhalant is that they might have a weird odor on their breath. You might actually see paint on their face or other chemical stains on their face or their hands or their clothes. You might find different bottles and cans of stuff or rags soaked in stuff in their rooms. And then, of course, evidence that they are intoxicated. The next slide is another prevalence slide of the use of various drugs. And again, what you see is the 8th graders, the 10th graders, and the 12th graders. This time you see that the black bar is the marijuana, the light pink bar is the cocaine, the gray bar, which is difficult to see, is the LSD, and the dark pink bar is the inhalants. The medical consequences of inhalants then are you can suffocate or asphyxiate yourself, you could accidentally injure yourself, and these things are very toxic to your brain, your kidneys, your liver, and your heart. They also suppress your bone marrow. So these are not sort of harmless things by any stretch of the imagination. This is again a slide of a slice of the brain. On the top is a normal brain. On the bottom is the brain of a person that used lots and lots of inhalants during their lifetime. And you could just see the shrunkenness. You know, the brain doesn't fill up all of the space. So that's what's going on over there. So that's briefly on the inhalants. Moving on to the anabolic steroids. So the anabolic steroids are used in medical practice. They are used for things like hormone problems, delayed puberty, breast cancer treatment, certain kinds of anemia, etc. The anabolic steroids, we've had them since 1935. They were used by the Germans in World War II as performance enhancers, and they started being used in the 40s by sports figures as performance enhancers. The testing didn't begin until the 1976 Olympic Games, and pretty much with every Olympics, there's always some controversy about who's using steroids. So this is, again, something that's not uncommon. Ben Johnson, just one of many people who was stripped of gold medal because of positive steroid testing most recently. Unfortunately, Lance Armstrong just basically got all of his records taken away seven times he was doing this. So that was a sad story. The street names for these drugs are roids or juice. They do have anabolic and androgenic effects. Anabolic meaning that they build you up. Androgenic meaning that they give you male characteristics. So they are a Schedule III controlled drugs. There's five schedules of controlled drugs, one being sort of the most serious and the most abusable, and they're in the middle in Schedule III. The characteristic users of anabolic steroids are bodybuilders and athletes, but there are also law enforcement that uses them, and military, and up to 3% of high school males and 1% of high school females use them. The main reason that people use them is performance enhancement. They want to do better at whatever activity they're doing. Some people use them because of a distorted body image where they want to increase their muscle size or reduce their body fat. And then other people, say in the military or if you're a bouncer, you might use them for self-protection or if you're in law enforcement. Anabolic steroids, yes, you can be addicted to them, like you can be addicted to any other substance. You can meet the DSM-4 criteria for dependence. If you do happen to meet that, there is a high rate of personality disorders, and the steroids tend to be used in a very sort of elaborate way. It's known in the culture as stacking or pyramiding, and that just depends on the way that you mix the steroids together. A lot of people use dietary supplements when they use steroids, and there are other drugs that they use in combination, such as HGH, which is human growth hormone, GHB, which we will talk about soon, that's gamma hydroxybutyrate, ephedrine, diuretics like Lasix to take off any excess fluid, and human chorionic gonadotropin, which is like the pregnancy hormone. So lots of these things are used in combination. Again, this is looking at both 10th graders as well as seniors, and what they show you is the lifetime use of these drugs as well as the perceived risk of harm. So you can see that 68% of people feel that this is a dangerous drug that was in 1 year and then it dropped in another year so that it was around 62%. And usually as the perceived risk of harm goes down, like they start to think it's harmless, then the lifetime use goes up. So that's what that slide is trying to show you. So there are multiple adverse effects of the anabolic steroids, and I won't read you all of these. I'll just tell you a couple of them. They can certainly cause heart attacks and strokes and high blood pressure. They can cause your growth plates in your bones to close prematurely. They can cause reproductive problems. And probably what gets talked about in the media is they can cause psychiatric problems like roid rage or mania or psychosis. And when the person is in withdrawal from these things, they can get depression, fatigue, and cravings. So here's just an example of a bodybuilder, and it shows you sort of all of the risks of steroids, sort of all on one slide. The next set of drugs is known as the club drugs. So the club drugs are what folks use at the big dance parties that are called raves. So raves are sort of huge dance parties, can be held in warehouses or very big halls, and people basically are there all night, and so they can get as big as 10,000 people at one event or even bigger, and the use of club drugs has extended well beyond raves, but that's where they started out. The use of club drugs appears to be escalating. They also are perceived to be safe, so it's okay to use these, but they can lead to serious health problems and even death, especially if they're combined with alcohol. Most of the club drugs that we know are tasteless, odorless, and colorless, so they are good to slip into drinks when a person isn't watching, and they can have a lot of different contaminants. And so what are some examples of club drugs? Well, we've already talked about one of them, and that is ketamine, or kitty Valium, but there's also ecstasy, GHB, and Rohypnol. So those are the ones that I wanted to cover. So ecstasy is an interesting drug. It's actually MDMA. It's methylene dioxymethamphetamine, and it has lots of different nicknames. It's either called X, ecstasy, Adam, Lover, Speed. In this country, it was actually legal until 1986, so you could just get it and use it. It is, why I said it was an interesting drug, is it's half speed and half hallucinogen. So it's almost like a combo drug. You can see just from its name that the last part of its name is methamphetamine. That's the speed part of it. And then the other parts of it gives it a psychedelic effect. So people can have not usually hallucinations, but just perceptual disturbances from it. And it does, a lot of times, gets mixed with all kinds of other contaminants and adulterants, such as caffeine or cocaine or speed. And ecstasy, you hardly ever meet someone who is an ecstasy-only user. Most people that use ecstasy frequently use other drugs. I mean, they just are what I call poly users. They use everything, a little bit of everything. So ecstasy, when you start to take it, it starts to act within about an hour. It lasts for 3 to 6 hours. What it does is it releases three kinds of neurotransmitters, serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine. And some of the effects of ecstasy are listed there. What people get is obviously the stimulation part of it, but they also get no other way to describe it except a warm, fuzzy feeling. So people that take this just feel like, it's kind of like peace and love. It's like being back in the 60s kind of thing. Increased alertness, and so that's on the one hand. And then on the other hand, some people can get undesirable effects from ecstasy, such as paranoia, hallucinations, and panic attacks. So those are the things that can happen. Here I'm showing you, just to get back to a moment to brains, and these are not human brains, thank goodness, these are monkey brains, but they basically show you what happens to your serotonin neurons in your brain after you've used ecstasy. So on the left-hand side is the normal brain. So you see lots of nice, healthy, lots of serotonin in that person's brain, lots of serotonin neurons. 2 weeks after the monkey was given the ecstasy, you see sort of a death of the neurons. They don't light up anymore. And then interestingly, even 7 years after the ecstasy, that hasn't gotten totally back to normal. So they have surmised that you can get permanent brain damage from using ecstasy in some cases. Not all cases, you know, but chronically using it, using a lot of it. Some of the adverse effects of ecstasy include heart problems. You can have cardiovascular collapse. So the people that have died on ecstasy have basically just have had heart attacks and major cardiovascular collapse. You can have problems with your sodium. When people mix ecstasy with Viagra, that can increase the risk of medical sequela. Also, as I had alluded to, it can cause possible irreversible damage to your serotonin neurons. And when you withdraw from ecstasy, you get depressed and confused and problems with your memory and attention. So then we have GHB, gamma hydroxybutyrate. And it's got some interesting slang names, probably one of my favorites, Georgia Homeboy, they call it, or they call it liquid ecstasy. The one that always makes me laugh is grievous bodily harm, because it's not even in the right order. So it's not even in the right order of the initials. It is easily manufactured. You can make this very easily. It is FDA approved, believe it or not, for the treatment of cataplexy, which is a neurological disorder where you have muscle spasms. And GHB is often used as a date rape drug and mixed with alcohol. So that's one of its common uses. It is a drug that you take by mouth. It starts working within about 10 or 20 minutes. It lasts up to 4 hours. And again, what you get is things that are very similar to drinking. You get sedation and drowsiness, you get loss of consciousness, it can, you know, decrease your breathing. As recently as, well, just in the last several years, there have been deaths reported even locally in our state because of GHB overdoses. So again, it can also be fatal in some cases. Rohypnol or flunitrazepam. So you might recognize the last few letters of that name and say, oh, it's related to diazepam. And in fact, it is. This is a benzodiazepine that you cannot get in the United States legally. It is legally available in Europe, and then it travels from Europe over to here. And so the Rohypnol is called Rofies, Forget Me Pill. In addition to coming from Europe, you can also get it from Mexico. It is commonly used as a date rape drug. It can impair a person for 8 to 12 hours. They are completely out. They won't remember what happened to them when they wake up. And the other side effects from them are the same as any other benzodiazepine. It's just that, again, it's gotten this negative reputation as a date rape drug. So that actually concludes my formal words to say on all of these different drugs. You may have questions about drugs that I didn't even mention. You may have questions about the drugs that I did mention. So this is your opportunity to ask. So I see some hands, and we can take a few questions before we wrap it up. So the question was, what is the treatment for PCP use, particularly in someone who's been using it for 9 years? What can you do? Someone that's been using it for that long and that regularly is a little bit unusual, for first of all. Most people just use it here and there, mix it with alcohol, other things. So I'm not sure how you would go about treating a person with that, to be quite honest with you. I mean, you know, certainly over time you could try and see if they could gradually decrease their use over time, because I have no idea how much this gentleman's using. But then as you get lower and lower on the drug, they probably would need to be on some sort of unit. But again, I'm not sure that a psychiatric unit would necessarily accept them, because again, psychiatric units are really for people who are, quote, danger to themselves and others, and not usually for PCP withdrawal type things. But that might be sort of one of the safest ways. I mean, again, I would need to have more of the history to try to figure out how to advise you. So maybe afterwards we can talk more, but it is a difficult situation because we don't have units that are specifically set up for that purpose. I mean, I suppose the most dramatic thing that you could do is just stop taking it and then observe what happens. But that would take sort of family support and, you know, having the number of the CIT officer that you could call in case something negative did happen. So, but yes, when you do read the literature, there is no well-described syndrome for us to describe, probably because there's so few people who take it in the way long term that you describe. So there's not enough people to study to see what actually happens when you take them off of it. But great question. So two questions were asked. The first question is, what is my personal opinion on medical marijuana and that whole movement? I'm actually totally against it. I am upset by it. We do have marijuana in pharmaceutical form. And so if people are going to use marijuana, then they should get it in that pharmaceutical form. I am totally against using smoked marijuana as any form of medication. I think it's dangerous. I don't think there's any way to control the purity. And I think you're just opening the door to more people having access to it. So, and then the second question that was asked was, how does marijuana affect our young people, particularly in our high schools? Possible effects on motivation and thinking and such. And yeah, I think it's a huge problem that is, again, sort of something we like to try to sweep under the rug. We don't like to talk about it, but if a quarter of high school students are using marijuana, that's a lot of our future workforce. And if of that quarter of people smoking weed, half of them get addicted, now you're taking more people out. And so it does have, I believe, long-term effects on your memory, your motivation, your concentration. So a lot of people aren't even in school anymore. They drop out. The heaviest of the marijuana users are dropping out long before they finish high school. So we have this whole, almost like a lost generation of people that has happened because of the marijuana. And so I think that cocaine and heroin get a lot more play on the news, but the marijuana is a lot more pervasive. You know, it's, you know, 10 times as common, and it's just out there, and it is very difficult to treat. So because people perceive it as, this is totally harmless, this isn't going to do anything bad to me, I don't, you know, in fact, this is helping my anxiety. So you've got a lot bigger hill to climb, I think, trying to get people off marijuana, whereas with the cocaine and the heroin, you know, there's such acute and major consequences that usually gets the person's attention, and they say, oh gosh, I got to do something about this. Whereas the marijuana, it's a little more low-key, but in my mind still has some devastating consequences for people. So, other questions or comments about the particular drugs? Yes?
Can I ask you a question about Subutex?
Is it Subutex? Yes. What is it?
Yeah, compared to
Suboxone? Great question. Yeah. So, as I told you, Suboxone is two drugs in one, buprenorphine plus naloxone. Subutex is just pure buprenorphine. So if a client got their hands on some pure buprenorphine, and if they wanted to, they actually could crush it up and shoot it. Are they going to get as high as they would from shooting heroin? Absolutely not. They'd get like a mild high. But what they won't get is they won't get thrown into the bad withdrawal because the subutex is pure buprenorphine without any naloxone. So that's the difference. And the reason we have subutex is because some people are allergic to the combo form, the suboxone. The other reason we have subutex is because that's the form that's used in pregnant women. So that's why we have two forms. Yes?
Are the treating requirements the same for subutex and suboxone? Yes. Only allowed 100 clients?
That's correct. So you can have 100 clients max on subutex or suboxone. It isn't 100 of each. It's 100 total, and it's the same rules. You have to have the 8-hour training course, that kind of thing, or you have to be an addiction medicine doctor or an addiction psychiatrist. Mm-hmm. Yes?
What's the distribution? Is it like 2 weeks?
What do you mean distribution?
As far as like the prescription for it?
Oh, yeah. Suboxone can be written a month at a time, and you are allowed to write refills for it, but what I usually do is not write a refill and have my patients come and see me every month. But I've seen doctors do it a little, more liberally than that. So does that answer your question? Is how much you can get at one time of the Suboxone?
I came across a question about a 14-day window that a person was given a script for.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes you speak of a 14-day window. Sometimes when you're just getting to know a patient and you're just starting them on the medicine, you may have them come in weekly for a couple weeks and then every 2 weeks for a couple weeks. And then when they're stable and you feel you can trust them and they trust you, then you can gradually spread it out to a month at a time. So that might be what you came across with your patient or client. So, all right. Well, thank you all very much. My throat almost didn't make it, but just barely made it. Thank you so much for your attention.